Okay, this started. So we will have now project presentations. Before, I just want to say a couple of words. So thank you for, for once more waking up early for the ones who do not do it usually. You have seen, of course, my controversial post about grading attendance. And I decided to do something a little bit different. I usually sleep over decisions and the night brings me advice. I'll not grade you for attendance, but my resource is limited. There is only me, I have only so many hours. So I decided I will take attendance, and there is this saying, help yourself that other people will help you. So the people who help themselves by coming to class, I'll give them the precedence when it comes to replying to their questions, basically, and following their projects. I think this is fair, you can choose, people can choose to stay home, because waking up early enough is so terrible. Well, fine, it's their choice. But I may give the precedence to the people who actually have a greater strength of will and actually show up in class and make the class lively. I think this is very fair. Okay, and so so here I have sheets, and I will be taking attendance, but not for grading, just for if I have to put in additional time to help projects, I will probably prefer the people that actually come. Okay? If there are objections, are there any objections to these? Well, you don't want to allow the voice them aloud. You can let me know, but I think this is a very fair policy, right? So this said, I leave the show to you, actually, so that you can present your projects. Okay, who wants to be first? Nobody. Is there anybody, raise your hand if you want to present. Okay, so there are at least two or three. Okay, would you like to come? Sorry, you're the closest one, so thank you.
So I didn't really have anything to present. I just wanted to ask if there's any bioinformatics people in this class. No? Yeah? What are you working on? Or do you want to like... Do you want to work together on a bioinformatics like project then?
Yes.
I was thinking like a plasmid design website where you store your strings and annotate and whatever. Anyways, whatever. That was my whole presentation, I guess.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, but thanks. I mean, this is what this is meant to be, so that you can see each other's faces and then you can connect afterwards. Anybody else wants to give a one second? Stand up. Would you like to come?
It's kind of the same thing, but just to give a little bit more like visual description, if anyone's ever heard of like a plasmid or like a viral vector, so a virus genome is like this circle, and we can use it in biology to do a lot of stuff. Like, you can put it in a cell to inject genes into it. You can, that's like one of the main reasons we use viral vectors, and it's a really big thing in biology right now. And so what I want to do is to use the UCSC genome database and query it for this viral genes. And what you'd be able to do is to, each one of these is a gene, and you can swap them out, swap them in, and then you'll get like a responsive like list of all the things your virus can do. And you could like save viruses and like share them with other people and make it like a kind of social thing. So just to elaborate what you said before, if anybody's interested in that, then talk to me or him. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Please.
So our basic idea is just we're making a student, like a student networking website. So you sign up, you just put your major, the classes you're taking, and then you're matched up with people who have a similar schedule to you or have the same major. And when you're matched, you can see like if they're looking for like people to study with, if they're looking for tutors, and if you want to help them, or you know, if you just want to like meet them for something, you send a request, and then if they want to meet you, they accept it, and then you get paired together. And yeah, that's pretty much it. Right now, we're just looking for someone for UI front end design. So just come to me if you want to join us.
Thank you. Anybody next? Anybody next than one? Anybody next than two? Okay.
So I'm sure a lot of us have, you know, used the 55 or 75 meal plan, and we're probably sick of the dining hall, so we never go there anymore. We probably use those meals at like Owl's Nest or Banana Joe's. But you know, like each meal is only worth $8, and you don't know if what else to get. So you get an ABC burger, that's only $5. But then do you really want to use a whole meal to get an ABC burger? So what I'm proposing is to create an app that can give you all the combinations that will add up to $8. Or like say two meals, that's $16. You'll be able to filter them and sort them. So that's my idea. Thank you.
By the way, for some of the projects are here today, like for this one, because I read it yesterday, this is a proposal which is interesting to read is on the spreadsheet. So I don't know if you made it readable to all or not, but people who want details, they can also look there. So you know, make the proposal readable by all by who has a link, if you want to, you know, others to be able to figure out what you're doing better. Anybody else would like to speak? Okay.
So I'm pretty much making a simple app that's going to be tracking NBA stats. On the top, it's going to have a bunch of boxes that are going to have all the live games. And you can click on it, and it's going to show all the stats for all the players who are currently playing, like their points, rebounds, assists, and everything like that. It's going to have a play-by-play section, and I'm going to be using API calls to update it about every 30 seconds. And then it's also going to be a stats reference, which is going to allow you to search for players and teams and see all the players and their stats for their averages and all their like previous games. And then the last thing I'm going to have is a section for like the top players of the week. And it's going to be updating at the end of every day and adding new players. And I'm looking for any teammates.
Thank you. Let me just add something to your project because it's one of the ones I read yesterday. This can potentially be an incredibly interesting project because the API, you plan to use it from the JavaScript inside the web pages.
Yeah.
And so there are lots of you know, things to learn in doing that. So let me just add this. So, fine. Okay. Thank you. So if you want to experiment with, you know, building apps so that basically they're working is mostly JavaScript in the page, you know, this might be a place to play with. Yeah. Anybody else wants to chat? Give a short. No? Silence. Him. No. Sorry. Okay. Great. So let me Let me give a few announcements and then pass to the part of the course that I want to do today. So I posted homework 3, okay? In homework 3, you have to do a wiki. Some portions, so the homework is posted and you need to use that. Otherwise, you know, it's next to impossible to do it. I mean, it's not next to impossible, but it's much harder. So the homework is posted as a Bitbucket repository that you have to clone. I put the cloning instructions so that you can get started in a quick way. Okay, so it contains an app that contains all the boring stuff done for you already, or boring slash perhaps a little bit more difficult. Okay, so this gives you a better start. If you clone it, you get something that looks like. Hang on. Well, why doesn't this work? Like this. Let me share the screen. Okay. So it's called SlugWiki. It contains a test controller that is not really useful for building your app, but that demos some of how these things work. If you use it, it's actually semi-cute. So this is the way it looks. Sorry. So I have to go to the administrative interface here. Let me make it bigger. So, okay, this is the main page that just contains something that I defined. Okay, but if you go to the test page, which is this, okay. I like to buy transformers. I don't know, I just wrote something completely at random. But the way it works is this. If you click on edit, I bring up a form, and the form will look like this due to some plugins that I installed already for you. This is why you need to download you know, my starter app. You can look at what I did. You will see the revision history in which I comment. Now I add this plugin, etc. So you can reverse engineer what I did pretty well. Okay. So here we can write something else. But for example, cats as pets. But I can also write it, I like cats. And then I can highlight it, and I can make it a link. And this makes it into a wiki link. I decided to use angle brackets, okay, as pets. So if I do this and submit and save this page, what this does is that you get these. And if you look at what cat is, unfortunately for you, it's too small. But this becomes a pointer to default index cats. Okay, so wiki links are translated into links to your own app, in which, as argument 0, you get the title of the page you want to fish out. Okay? So this is the principle. So I did the sort of UI portion, which is kind of the harder one, because you would have needed to know how to install these plugins. Okay? So you instead have to build, in this and in the next homework, I divide the work in two. This homework, you basically have to do, you know, just adding revisions while you edit a page, you know? But you need to build a wiki with its various logic, okay? So this is homework 3, okay? I advise you to start early because I don't think it's actually incredibly long, but it's a bit more sophisticated than the other homeworks, okay? So I think it's... this is a gut feeling, okay? And I don't know how good you are, but I think that probably for 2/3 of you, it's impossible to do it if you start the last day. This is just my gut feeling from Piazza, but maybe I'm wrong. Maybe you can all do it in the last day. I don't know. I wouldn't try, though. Okay? I really wouldn't try. So this is it. And what I want to do today are two things. So the first is that I want to talk a bit about input forms and validation a little bit better, because you need it for the homework, and because it's actually quite important. And the second thing I want to do is to talk about how to pass information from one access to the next. This was a very good question that someone of you asked at the end of one of the classes, and I thought I should do that in a more systematic way in class. I'm not sure whether I will have time today or not. Okay, so that's the program. Great. Now, let me start. by taking maybe one of these old apps, so I don't have to create one from scratch. I can take the Bbard app. Let's see whether it still works. Sorry, I didn't want to go here. I want to go here. So this is a bulletin board. Okay, fine. So I can add posts, etc., etc. So let me take this as a starting point and do something with it. Okay. So this is the index. So we have so many windows open here that it gets me confused. It leaves me confused. 1 second. By the way, sorry, if I do things out of order, but I wanted to show you these. These, I apologize for the small font, but this is SUS3, a programmer from Altassian, the people that make Bitbucket. I think that SUS3 is actually the best visual interface, except GitK, but GitK is really hard to install. So this is the best user interface for looking at Git repositories. This is a repository I built while preparing the homework for you, okay? So I have an initial commit, and you can look at my various commits. And if you look at, for example, displaying a wiki page in our works, you can see the code changes that I did, okay? In this case, it's just two pieces of code that I needed to change. Then you know each one of my edits. Actually, you can see it. I start from a very from a completely plain app, and you can see exactly my work. Okay, and when you clone it, you will have it. And I highly recommend this because it gives you this sort of visual way of looking what's happening. And in fact, I like this so much. You know, Bitbucket has, as I wrote, this very nice setting that. You can have unlimited repositories as long as you have only 5 collaborators. And if you sign up with an academic email address, as you have via ucsc.edu, then I think you can also add other email addresses, but you actually get unlimited collaborators. So it's a fantastic fantastic deal for you. And I would like to ask you for the projects to do them in Git, you know, putting a branch in Bitbucket. I mean, I already asked you to do them in Git, but I would like a branch to be there and me to be one of your collaborators. So I can actually see the code if I ever need to, and if I ever like. And you know, I do look at the code of the projects. Okay? Yeah, there is a question. I would like you to use in Git you don't need to use only one repository. You can have multiple remotes. So if you prefer GitHub for your work, use GitHub. Just on your, every now and then push to Bitbucket as well, so I can see the work there. Okay? Just to keep it all in the same place so that I can see essentially what's happening. Actually, yeah, I don't mind so much. You can also use GitHub if people want. But I would like to have a link to the repository so that I can go see, you know, what people are actually doing. Sorry. Okay, so back to the code. This was our simple wiki, and I wanted to take so we know the databases, but the tables. By the way, I don't know if somebody was bitten by it, but I call this file tables because it's a reasonable name, but also because it begins with T. The files in models are executed in alphabetical order. If you call your file something like bbard.py, then it would be executed before db.py. And this would lead to trouble because the db object that you use to create tables is defined in db. Okay, so the order of execution, as a reminder, when Web2Py gets a request, it executes everything in models sequentially, in alphabetical order. Okay, so if you want a special order, you can also say 001, 002, you know, whatever, if you as file names, if you want to enforce, like you know, in the good old days of BASIC, I guess, right? But then then it executes one of the controllers. Okay, and I will talk later about the what kind of sort of semi-global variables you have. Now I want to, so there is a table bbard, okay, which we have already, and which is fine. And I want to define another one, db define table I don't know, bblog, okay? I just want an example of a table that I use for some side reason, and I have a field user ID, which is a reference to DB auth user, and then I might have like a field. Well, let me copy a few of these, okay? And then I have also field special, okay, which I will fill in some way. I just want to give you some examples of how to do things. So suppose I want to add a bulletin board entry, okay? One of the ways to do it, as we have seen, is in this line here to build an SQL form that contains everything that we actually want to put in the post, okay? Now, for flexibility, I want to show you some other ways to put the information in and some other ways to do the validation, okay? Just to show to you the degrees of freedom that you have that may be useful in your work. So let me copy these. Okay, I might copy it here. Let me call it add indirect. So essentially, this creates a form that is copied from the database table, but I can also do create an SQL form in any way I want. And one of the easy ways to do it, to create a form, is to pretend that you have a table that does not exist, but if you had it, it would be what you would like. So you do SQL form.factory. If the TA can please check that the factory is lower or uppercase, I forget these kind of things. Okay. So, and here I can define fields. So these fields are not created, but essentially I'm pretending that I have a database table that looks like that. So I can say, for example, field title. Okay. Then I can say field, I don't know, message. Okay. And this is a text field. And then I can have some fields that I can do something like, I'm just making a silly example, okay, because I want a quick example. But for example, I can put here, hold on. How it is called these three numbers in a phone number, the area code, okay? Area code. And I can say that this is an integer. And then I can say, for example, field, that this is a phone, like local number. Okay, and they said that this is an integer as well. Okay, so suppose I do this. And then, suppose I actually just do this. What would happen? Well, it would break because I haven't added the corresponding view, but let me add it. Okay, I just copied the other view, so I did not waste time. Now, let me switch to it. Oh, it's because I require login, fine. Okay. So you see, this is not the form we had before, but it's the form as if I had a table that really had those fields. And you can put in all the various things that you might want. For example, here in the area code, I can say requires is equal to integer. Can the TA look it up? Integer in range, I think it's called. Integer in range, or maybe is in range, but you know, 0, 9, 9, 9. It's in the validators. If you can just check a second there. In range, without int in range is int. Okay, thank you. Yeah. So if I do this, you know, this should still work. Yes. But now, you know, if I try to put this as a this as a code, it will tell me that it doesn't work. Okay. Oh, 998. So actually, I should modify my code and put 1,000 here. Okay. So this is a way in which you can very easily build forms to your liking. You are not constrained by the way your database tables look like. Now, suppose that you don't want a form that is blank, but you want to prefill some information. Okay, how do you prefill information here? Well, you do this. So these are like database fields, and in a database field, you can define a default value, right? So you can do the same here. Default is equal to 831, okay? So if I do this, and I reload this, actually, I don't want to reload the post. I just want to, yes, you see now this defaults to 831. And these are defaults that you can generate dynamically. For example, you can have let me make an example that might be useful. I say post is equal to db board of 1. This will get the thing with ID 1, okay? And then I say that the previous text previous text is equal to p dot, how did I call it, the text? Sorry. I called it bb message, okay? P dot bb message, okay? And then I can say that the message as default bb message, okay? So I can also do things like this. Let's see what happens. Yeah, previous text, thank you. So if I do this, okay, this has a record that populated this. Okay, so this gives you some idea of how you can do things actually unrelated from the database if you ever need to. Why am I telling you this? Okay, think at how a wiki works. I wrote this in the instructions, but I just want to make it clear. Think of how a wiki works. In a wiki, you are reading a page, right? You read the page on cats. Then you want to edit it. But when you edit it, you're not rewriting the page. What you're doing is this. You read the most recent revision of the page cats, okay? And that's what you present on the screen to the user. That's what you have to do, okay? Then when I decide to edit the page for cats, I'm not actually editing that revision. You show to me that revision as the default value that I have before I start editing, okay? And when I click the button save, what you do is that you save that as yet another revision with me as the author, okay? I mean, I guess all of you know how wikis work, you know, if you have edited Wikipedia or played with a wiki. So if you don't know, well, I don't quite want to tell you to go play with Wikipedia, but I guess they have a sandbox that you can play with, actually, in Wikipedia. So, but the idea is the same, you know, every page has a sequence of revisions, and when you edit the page, you actually just create a new revision, okay? So that's why I'm giving you these hints on the degrees of freedom you actually have. Now, another thing is this. Suppose I have a form, and now let me go to this edit thing here, and I want to make another controller that is called edit edit plus. Okay, because it's a sort of better version of edit. So I want to edit a post. Okay, so here let me copy this into edit plus. Okay, so what I want to show to you is this. Here I'm instead choosing to use a traditional form. Okay. I build a form and then I process it. The problem is this. What can you do if when you process a form, you want to do some extra work, okay? I mean, if you just process a form that comes from the database, this will just store it. But how can you have it do some interesting work? Let's start with validation. Some validation, you can put it inside in the individual fields. For example, you can say the phone number is all made by numbers, but there is some validation that might cut across. For example, suppose that you are asking my address, okay? You might want to check that if I put the area code for the US, then I give the US as a country, or I guess Canada because of this weird situation. But you know, many other countries have their own area code. And so you would like to check that if I put France, I put 33, Italy 39, Germany, what is 44, I guess. No, 44 is the UK. Germany is 40? I don't know. I forgot what is Germany. You might want to do checks that go across multiple fields, and you might also want to compute extra things. So let's start with a bit of these checks. Let me do a very, very simple check for this area code to phone number correspondence, okay, just as an exercise. So here in the BBoard table, we have already a phone, but let me add here also a field area code. Integer requires is equal to is int in range between 0 and 1000, okay, and field okay country, okay, so fine. Now I will have also these fields. How do I check that these two match? Okay, clearly I cannot do it here. So what do I do? I do the following. Yeah? So I need a comma here. Sorry. Thank you. Yeah, great. Thanks. Thanks so much. Okay, let me go to the code. So in this edit plus, now we want to do this check, okay? So here, I can specify a validation function to which I pass the form. And in that validation function, I can do various things. Can you check whether it's called validation or validate? I'm sorry, I'm using my TA as the Google search specialist. But validation is equal to validate form, okay? Validate edit form, for instance, okay? Where this is a general function, okay? Is it validation? Validate, okay? So here I have to provide a function that takes as input a form and does the validation. And let me write one such function. You can write it either after, or Python does let you write functions one inside the other. So in this case, I just define it here. Def validate edit form. Okay, this takes as input a form. And then let me just write some very simple rules. If form.vars, how did I call it? Area code. Eh? Yes, area code and country. If forms.vars.area code is equal to 1, if form.vars.country different from US, okay, or I can guess I can say and, okay. So if this happens, then I want to label an error. I have a choice. Do I want to signal the error on the area code or on the country? I don't know. You know, it's up to you. But let me put it somewhere. Form.errors.area code is equal to translate. This T constructor that I use from time to time is a translation constructor. If you ever wanted to internationalize your website, This T will look at the English string you give it, will look it up in a translation table for the specific language you are using. I'm not going to do translation for you in this class, but essentially, if you you know, that's a translation helper. So T is wrong area code for the US. Okay, and you can say elif form dot vars dot area. Code is equal to 39 and form.vars country different from Italy, then you can say the same thing, almost, okay? So you can say these. Okay, I think that's all is needed, okay? So let's try it a moment. The problem is that now I have to change some reference to edit to edit plus, okay? Let me look how this bboard looked if I just went to the index. I just want to have the easiest way to find it. Okay, fine, I have an edit link in the index there. It's probably here that I need to change it. Yes, and I put edit plus, okay? So let's see how this works. Now I want to edit this post. Okay, now you see I have area code and country, and now I say one and I say Italy. Sorry? Oh, wow. Why?
Because you didn't refresh the HTML.
Oh, bizarre. I thought I did. But thank you very much. You're absolutely right. Right. Okay, this is edit plus. Now I can say one. I can say Italy. Okay. Updated. Okay. So I made a mistake, evidently. Okay. What is the mistake? Any idea? Is it form.error or form.errors? No. Okay, no, I don't know. I may need to look at the documentation. Anybody can look at a moment, or should I? Sorry? Do I have to say return form? Let me try. No.
It's the
sorry?
It's the logic. You're only checking if the area code equals 39.
Yeah, but I'm checking that you and form vars country is different from US. Right? So the area code is one, but the country is Italy and not the US. So the logic should give me an error, right? Well, let me brute force it, okay? Let me just copy this line without an if then in front so that I can just see what happens. Okay, so. No, it's this form.errors.area code that is not working. Sorry? I beg your pardon? No, I think this would work because when I go here, you see, I'm having some error. I'm sorry, this usually always works. I usually know how to do this. Should I look at some example of documentation? So let me tell you where the documentation is. On validation, okay. So the TA's fault. No, I'm just kidding. All together, all together. Okay, let me try, and if this doesn't work, you know, I will search a moment myself. So I go here, I reload this, okay, I submit, and now I get the error, okay, it was on validation, okay, a simple error there. So, and if now if I remove this line, which was kind of a fake, if I remove this line, and I try to submit again, you know, it would tell me wrong area code for the US. But if I put US here, instead, the thing will be validated, okay? So this is a nice way to do validation. Okay, so this works. But I can do a little bit more. Imagine that there is another validation that I might need to do. For instance, I want to check that the old value, okay, it's a stupid check, but I don't know what interesting check. I want to relate it to old values. For example, that once you put the area code, you cannot change it. I mean, it's an arbitrary check, but I want to essentially answer this question. How can you pass values to this function? Okay, there are two ways. One way is that since it's defined inside here, this is probably the easiest way, no? I can say things like, if form.vars.areacode, I can say if p.areacode is not none, and form.vars.areacode is different from p.areacode, okay, form.errors area code is this, okay? So this would prevent me from changing the area code. Let's see whether this works. I can go back. Okay. I just want to reload these. I don't want to confirm any. Okay. Now I put instead, you know, 33 France, which is okay by the other rules. I say submit, and I get the message I cannot change the area code, okay? Now, a bit of Python marvel, because I don't know that all of you know how to do this. So this is solution number one, okay? There is another equivalent way of doing this. I don't want to delete this because I want you to have this in the code. So let me just copy it and call one the alternate way of doing things. And let me go to the other way and do it in a different way. So if this function becomes long, it's really a bit awkward to leave it inside the code, right, of your controller. So suppose I want to write it in some other place, like below. I think normally I define a shortcut to reflow code, but the Python code, but here I miss it, so sorry, I have to do this by hand. Okay, so suppose I do this. Hey, where did the P go? The check for P, oh, here. You see, now the problem is that P would be an undefined variable, okay? So the problem here is that I would really have to pass to the validation the old form. But the problem is that the function that I need to send to on validation needs to be a function of one argument, actually, okay? That this function needs to just get a form as argument. So how do I solve this, you know? How can I still have my validation that depends on the old value? I can do it this way. Actually, this was correct. I shouldn't have changed it. Oops, sorry. Oh, no. Redo. Redo. Okay, great. Okay, fine. Here we have it. So I need to return a function that gets only a form. But I can do, here somehow this got out of sync. I can do this, okay? Def, like edit plus validation, and this takes previous rec, okay, for the previous record. This function will define inside a function that takes a form where instead of p, I write previous record, okay? And then this outer function, edit plus validation, will do return validate edit form. So you see what I'm doing? I'm doing a function of one parameter called previous record that returns itself a function. I'm not sure if you are used to it so much. Some of you will be. But you know, integers are values. Floating point numbers are values that you can assign to variables. But in Python, functions are also values that you can assign to variables. Okay? That's not the case in Java, unfortunately. In Java, if you want to pass around a function, if I want to give you, hey, this is a function f, you know, just call it with one argument, you will be fine. If I want to do that in Java, I have to package a function inside an object, okay? In Python instead, you can just use the function as a variable, okay? I mean, assign a function to a variable. So this edit plus validation is defining a function here, it validated it form, and it's returning that same function, okay? So here I can say, edit plus validation of p, okay? So the function that on validation needs will be the output of edit plus validation of p. Is this clear or not? It's a bit incontroverted if you have never seen this before. But in Python, you might very well write a function that has return value as another function. There is absolutely nothing preventing it. Is this clear? Yeah, questions? Yeah?
Why don't I, sorry? This function, so you're essentially asking why validated inform does not return name? Okay? I mean, this function does not have a return statement. I could write it if I wanted, right?
But it wouldn't change anything. So, I don't know if this is your question, but you're asking me why don't I write something like return?
No, I was going to ask the edit plus validation returns validated form, but it doesn't use parentheses there. I wasn't that's like
how you return functions. No, it's because you know form is a formal parameter of validated edit form. I don't need to pass it also to the outer function. Like, you know, I can say, I can say this, you know, I can define like expo of n in this way, okay? I want to return a function that will exponentiate a number to the exponent 10, okay? And I can say def f of x, and this x is arbitrary, and I can say sort of, you know, I don't know, return x to the n, x to the n, okay? And then I can say here, return f. So this function here, is a return. Okay, so this thing here is a function, and this is what I return. So sorry, I'm not sure I answered your question. Sorry? No, no, say it again once more time.
So you're returning the function that calls the function.
I'm returning the function, yes. Because onValidate wants a function of one argument. And it will pass the form as that one argument. So that's why I'm doing it this way. Essentially, if onValidate could take a function of arbitrary arguments, you know, I would maybe not need to do it in this way. But in onValidate, I need to pass a function that just takes one argument and I cannot pass anything else. So this is a sort of trick in order to build on the fly the right function to pass to onValidate. Okay? Yeah.
So onValidate always passes a form as an argument even though it's not like specified?
Yes, yes, yes.
because inside the code that does this form processing, which you can read, by the way, you can see, you know, in the SUS distribution of Web2Py, but the code will do, you know, a lot of stuff, and then at some point we say, okay, now I have my form. So what happens to a form when you get it? It first what happens is that Web2Py will validate the requirements that you have written in the database table itself. For example, if you say that something is a string or something is an integer, you know, it will validate those things first. Okay. Once it has done all the validation that is based on the table definition, it says, do I have any other validation to do to this form I have now? And it will look at onValidate. If onValidate is none because you didn't specify it, then it will not do anything extra. If onValidate contains a function, it will call the function that you gave to onValidate on the form it has. That's how it works. Very good question, by the way. Thanks. Okay. So here is how you can do additional validation. Now, one of the things that you can do as well when you have a form is this. When you have a form, what was it? Where did I put it? Now I have so many controllers. But this is add indirect, okay? Now, let me come back, not to validation, but what to do with forms. Once you have a form and you process it, you can decide what to do. If the form does not have a physical table, like this one, when the form is accepted, actually, all you have done is validate it. Okay? If there was a real table, this would have written the editor to, or the addition to the table. But here there is no real table, so there is no place where to write it, so nothing happens. So what's the use of this? The use of this is that you can do yourself things by hand. For example, successful processing, let's insert these into the dboard table, okay? And I can say db id, because you know when you insert a piece of data into a table, it's assigned a new fresh id that is obtained by incrementing the largest id in the table. I think I told you this, right? So every row in a table has a unique ID, and when you insert the data, it gets an incremented ID, auto increment ID. Okay, so if you insert some data inside a table, the ID is actually something that the database tells you. You don't usually specify the ID when you're on insertion, because otherwise you might be overwriting some older data, or you know, funny stuff might happen. So when you insert the ID, is something you get out of the database, and so you say db.bbard. And I can say db.bbard.insert, and then you know you can specify what happens to the fields like bb message. I hope I called it this way. Okay, I should maybe look a moment. It has a. Let me just fill a couple of these fields, not to bbard, but there is bb message and title or country. I just fill a couple of them. Bb message is equal to form.vars.message. Okay, and then I can say that area code is equal to form.vars.area code. Okay, so this gives me the ID. Okay, sorry. Thank you. And then I can take this ID if I define another table here that I did define that is bblog. User ID, let me call, for example, field, item ID, okay, and this is an integer. Let me simplify a little bit this, okay, let me just do this. So I can decide to insert it, in another table as well, okay? So now I can say db bbard.insert, and in this case I'm sort of disregarding the other statement, the other item ID is equal to ID, and then what did I want to do? Title is equal to this is a log, okay, and special is equal to I don't know, no,
Okay. So, I mean, this is a bit of a boring example, but this just gives you the idea that you actually have full control on what happens after you process a form and the form is accepted, okay? Don't think that the only thing you can do is, you know, the data gets inserted in a table. You actually can write, and you obviously often do, you can write entirely arbitrary code that will do whatever you ever want to one or multiple tables, okay? And if you want, you can also make these be part of the same transaction, okay? One of the reasons I'm telling you this is that, you know, you might need it in the next homework, by the way, because, you know, when you create a new revision of a page, what do you need to do? Well, you need to write a new revision and, you know, maybe you need to adjust some bookkeeping somewhere around other tables if you wish, okay? So, so this is quite common, okay? Sorry? Yes. Yeah, it's good that I don't plan to run all the code I present. Okay. But so this would insert it in both places, essentially. Okay. So, so this is one of the two solutions. So there is also another solution that I don't want to dwell into because I choose not to. I mean, I myself don't use it very much. But even if you create a form based on a database table, there is a way to tell to the to give an argument to the processing of the form that says process it, but actually don't write anything to the database. And in that way, that also gives you full control of what you do with the information. Okay, so essentially the form processing happens in this way: the form arrives from the web browser by having this form dot. So when the form arrives, let me just maybe, no, I can write it as a comment here so that you have it together. Form processing. Okay, so what happens is this one info arrives for each field as request dot vars dot for example name, okay. Two, form validation happens moves these to form dot vars dot name, okay. And then any additional validation you can do set form dot errors name if you wish, okay, and this is essentially how the information flows in a form, okay. And so after the form is processed, you still find the values the user gave you into form dot vars dot name of the information, okay. So okay, this is a bit detailed, but it's actually very very useful because this gives you the ingredient to do essentially whatever you want at this point. You can build the forms exactly that look whatever you want, regardless of how the database is defined. When you process the form, you can have exactly what you want happen, regardless of, you know, any behavior that might be built in the logic, okay? So there are even more manual ways to build forms. You know, if you wanted to go through the trouble, you could actually define the form in HTML, and you could also do the validation yourself. I basically never do it, however, because I find this very handy. If there is no form, if there is no database table that I need to that has the right shape for me, I define a form using SQL form.factory, which I find very handy. And if I need, then I use a CSS or JavaScript to, you know, hide some fields or style it just in the right way for when I present it visually. Okay, so yeah. If there are no questions, I'd like to make a break. You can write your name and email here, and in the second part of the class, I will talk about how to pass values from one part of the other to the app. Okay? Are there any questions before I break? Yeah.
What variable type is this ID?
This ID. Okay, what variable type? Yes, this is a very good question, and it's also a complicated one, because in general you don't know, and it's a bit of a pain. The problem is that the reason you don't know is that it depends on the database. Postgres, MySQL, and typically SQL databases use integers. Actually, they use long integers. Okay, so that you're not limited by 2 billion. You know, it can be an arbitrarily large number. I mean, yeah, in Python is arbitrarily large, I think, long integers. Okay. Now, if you were using other databases as the backing store, you can attach these, say, to MongoDB. Then that might be a string. And so unfortunately, this is one of the places that might not be entirely compatible if you change to various, you know, from one database to the other behind. If you stick to SQL databases, that's most likely be an integer. Yeah?
So when you do the DB before insert, it will return the ID of the DB?
Yes. This will record the ID of the newly inserted data. And here you say, well, you know, what do we do with the return value? In Python, if the function has a return value, you can just call it without doing anything with the return value, and it will be just be thrown out. Okay, you're thrown away. Another thing that I want to tell you, since we talk about these IDs, is the following: that here, suppose you have the, you know, this classical insert function, successful processing, but where did it go? Okay, so suppose you want to know, in the case in which I use an SQL form and actually I let it insert a new data, where is the new data? Where is the ID of the new data created? So the answer is in form.vars.id. So if you need to fish it out, that's where it goes if Web2Py inserts the data for you. Okay, it's always available there. I mean, that's very useful, obviously. Imagine that after you insert data, you need to send people to a page where they can, you know, see in all the glory the data they just inserted. Then you need to know the ID, obviously. Okay. Note also another thing: we have in this class the habit of just using the ID as the thing that we put into the URL. Okay, this is very common, but it. I'm not sure it's actually fantastically ideal if you do a commercial company. Why? Because, as you know, if you have used CrowdGrader, that does the same thing because I didn't care enough. You can, for example, know precisely how many people have made a homework submission to CrowdGrader. Because these IDs are auto-increment. So if you see a certain ID, like right now is about 27,000, you know that 27,000 homeworks have been submitted. Okay, and if you do a startup, you may not want people to know how big you are. It's, you know, you may want to keep a secret, except for your investors, how many users you have. You know, I mean, Google Plus is not going to tell you the number of active users or posts per day or these kind of things, right? So one thing that you might want to do is to use a reversible hashing function in which essentially you take these IDs, you encrypt them in some way that is reversible, and you might get a bigger string. And then in the controller, when you get this bigger string, you sort of reverse engineer, you reverse translate it, and then you get the idea of the thing you actually want to access. Okay? So this is a thought. If you are doing things commercially, you might want to keep a little bit more secrets for you, okay, rather than giving directly the idea of stuff in the database. Okay? It also might protect you a little bit better from some attacks. Because if you get if you could get a backdoor to the database, if you use IDs as identifiers, you would directly know which roles are involved, and it might be better not to give out that information actually. Okay, so those are some considerations. Okay, any other question? Okay, so start early on the wiki homework, but I think I basically gave you the basic ingredients. What you have to do is not very hard, provided that you can decide yourself what to do with the forms once, you know, people edit a revision. That's, you know, the only non-trivial thing that that is to be done. I believe, you know, but of course, you know, developing is tricky and there are many ways to make mistakes, but I think that's the only thing that is non-trivial. Okay. Let's make a short break so you can also meet the other people and, you know, sign your names if you like. Yeah? Let me get my...
Okay, in this thing, What's X is N. Oh, he's an N. I guess what I don't get is what is X with the value? You don't have to give the value to X. Yeah, it's just that course some secret parameter like an on value. I don't know. Hopefully I can talk to
I think we can parallelize the process, by the way. So I have a couple of other forms that are identical. So
parallelize.
But we cannot parallelize a pencil.
So when you created the validator function, the new function for validator.
Yeah, this one. So, yeah, you have to make
You're
great.
Or is it funny?
Hey,
it's good to know that you also use OU. I'm also used to. Here, I think it goes. What's the spelling of previous they use in US? Is it OU? I mean, I'm still used to the British spelling.
I think previous. Previous is always this. I think it's always spelled this way, yeah. Yeah, but I'm also mixed up because I used to speak British and which one's up on the ground.
My spellings are
all
mixed up.
What did I want to ask you? There is a student with a very funny problem. I don't know if you'd like to come to my office after. Yeah, because she has downloaded a bad application history, and since she's not able to check the code out. We need to check.
We didn't realize we would need to
invite you. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so
let me start again. You can write it at the end or something like that.
Okay. So what I would like to do now is to talk about how to pass values between calls of Web2Py. I was asked essentially this question: are there things like global variables, you know, how do you pass the information around? And this is actually a really good question, so I want to comment a little bit about it. Okay. So, a moment, please. There are global constants that you can define. If you have a global constant, you can define it in db.py, and everything you define there will be available everywhere else. So if you go into not only db.py, but also tables.py, I usually put my definitions here. And so if I write, for example, happy number is equal to number is equal to 8. Okay, I don't know what a happy number is supposed to be in different cultures, but if I do this, this happy number will be available all over the place. So for example, in here, you know, I will have it available. You know, I could copy a section of this code and I could do this. Sorry, I should actually copy something like this, you know. So this code is meaningless, but it will work, okay? I can write it here and it will be defined. I don't know. Something like this, okay? So this would work. So things that you define there in db.py are defined throughout. This is simply because, you know, db.py is run each time, okay? And so that's why they are there. But you do not have global variables that persist across calls. So for example, if I have a variable that is called counter and I try to say counter is equal to counter plus one in one of my controllers, yeah, you can do it, you know, but the next call will not have the incremented value, okay? So how can you do these things? So this is also related to logins and shopping carts in some way. When you access our Web2Py website, the first thing Web2Py does behind the hood is this. You do a GET request, say, for the home page of your site, and Web2Py says, hey, this request, does it come with something called a session cookie, yes or no? Okay. Now, let me give you an example with CrowdGrader and to show you the session cookie, just because CrowdGrader, I know how it works, and is written in Web2Py, okay? So now I call up, actually from an incognito window, so that I'm not already logged in if I would be. I call up CrowdGrader, okay? Actually, maybe first let me open the developer tools. Okay, I open the developer tools. Let's increase the font a bit and let's see what happens. So I want to go into the network tab, okay? And now I can do this request to one too many. I do the request, boom, and this is what happens. So let's not bother about the home page, but let's look instead at the request, okay? You see that this is the first request. It's a GET and it's an OK. So I can click on it and I can look at the details. And I can look at the details and the request cookies, I'm sorry, the request cookies are empty. So you remember, when you access with a browser or website, the browser will automatically send to that website the cookies that belong to that website, okay? If I define a website www.crowdgrader.org, whenever you go to it, all the cookies that are associated with www.crowdgrader.org will be sent to it, okay? That's the rule of the browser, okay? So what happens? In my request, I have no cookies. Why? Well, because it is an incognito window, and so I'm starting afresh like a person that has never been there before, okay? But the first thing CrowdGrader does, not CrowdGrader per se, but Web2Py does, is it gives you a session cookie. What is a session cookie? It's just a big random number, actually a big random string. I don't know how big, but, you know, fairly big. And the name of these is called Section Data CrowdGrader and Session ID CrowdGrader. So I don't want to go into exactly the details of this, what these cookies are, but essentially gives you this ID. Okay. At this point, Web2Py stores in a database this information. And you can decide where it's stored, but by default, it's stored in a database. I will show you where it is defined. Okay. It will have a session. It will have a session cookie, okay, and then it will have a session information, and this can be pretty much what you want. Often there is not much, but you can add information to that. So where is this table? This table in by default. Is defined as part of the data, is defined as one of the database tables. And if you see, it's this line here that does it. Session connect request response db is equal to db. This is a bit of a cryptic line, but if you look at the documentation Web2Py, it tells you that essentially that the session is made out of a request and of a response, and it is stored in a database that is actually the DB database that you have defined there. Okay? In CrowdGrader, for instance, I do not store sessions in the database. Why do I not? Because if you store them in the database, the only awkward thing is that they will be there forever and this is deleted. So if you start to get a lot of visitors, your session table will grow unbounded. And then you should by hand do some maintenance and say, hey, you know, let's remove the sessions of the people that are, you know, are older than a month or two weeks or so. And I just, you know, personally hate this kind of maintenance. And so in CrowdGrader, I've done it in such a way that that is maintenance free. Okay. Essentially, I do a mix of storing the information in the cookie itself, we're using some funny trick, and in the memcache that is available in the Google Cloud. The memcache persists for some hours, for some days, sometimes, but it goes away by itself. It cleans itself automatically. So I never have to worry about, you know, my session table becoming too full. But essentially, session is an object that persists for the individual user from call to call. I think you're all familiar with it. When you go to Amazon, you don't log in yet, and you start putting stuff in your shopping cart. How does Amazon know what you're putting in the shopping cart? And notice that if I put, you know, five items in my shopping cart and then I log in, I still have the access to those five items, right? It is not that they disappear because now I'm another person. They're persistent. So where does that information go? It goes in the session table. Okay. Whenever you access Amazon or CrowdGrader, you give it the right cookie. And Web2Py or whatever Amazon is using will look up your session cookie, and it will read your session information, which in the case of CrowdGrader is actually pretty boring. But in the case of Amazon, it contains the IDs of the stuff in the shopping cart, among other things. Okay. So you can use that information yourself. Let me make a small controller that will count how many times you access it, okay? That is based on the session. The session is information is available to you. Sorry, this is index.html. I will need it, but I need the default. Okay, so I go somewhere. Oh boy, too much stuff. I go here and I say def count, okay? And I define a small counter. So I write the following code. If session, so session is the object, session is this object that is stored in the table, and it's essentially a dictionary that you can access with this funny dot notation that I mentioned already. So I can say if session dot count is none, okay, session dot count is equal to one, else session dot count plus equals one. Okay, this is not perhaps the most concise way to write it. If you want to write it better, you would write session dot count. Well, okay, fine. Let me forget about it. I'm not doing a class on Python. It's on. Okay, so this increments it, and then I can do a return dict like count is equal to session count. Okay, so I have this. Okay, and now I need to build, oh boy, I wanted something a little bit smaller than this. Okay, so I need to build the view, right? So I just build a very minimal view that says count, I guess. Okay, so let's see how this works. I can go to default count. Oh no. Whatever did I make? Oh, field special is in an unrelated thing. Yeah, great. Doing too many things in the same controller is not a good recipe. It's because I forgot the comma there. Okay, let me hope that this is my only error. Okay, one, great success. Now I load it again and it tells me two. You know, we are really making progress, you know. You know, think at, you know, once upon a time you just called add in assembly language. Now instead, you know, we have cookies, database, I mean, everything, database access, all to increment a number, but it works. Unbelievable, right? Now, if I go to the same URL from another session and I go here to my handy incognito window, okay, so if I go it from here, hang on. This starts from one, obviously, okay, because these two browsers have independent sessions, right, because this is my incognito window. Now, if I go here instead and I open another tab and I go to the same place, you know, this instead will share cookies and so will share the session, so it goes to five, okay? So this is, you know, on Amazon, I'm sure that you have noticed, you open multiple tabs because you look for, I don't know, a book and a screwdriver and you know, you search on both, but when you add stuff to the cart, if you add the book in one and the screwdriver in the other, then they are both in your cart, you know? So that's basically how it works. It's information associated with the session. This also tells you some of how login works. Well, how does it work when you log in? I don't want to go into the gory details of how it is implemented in Web2Py, also because I never fully dissected how it works, okay? But the main way in which it works is this. This session cookie and session information essentially will say, there will be a table that says, hey, this user here with this session cookie is actually a logged in user. Okay, so the session is information is also used to mediate logins. Okay, so basically, a modern browser, if you shut off cookies, you know, few things work because the site stops having any information from about you from one access to the next. So you completely break the model in which the browser is giving you something personal, okay? Now, you might think, okay, fine. Unfortunately, I have no global variable. Perhaps I can have at least some other way of sharing information. So I can write it to a file. So there are some people who do that, right? So they share information writing to files. This is something that I don't like to do. I think it's a bad idea. But let me tell you how to transform this bad idea into a good idea. You say, I have this information, for example, account, and I want to write it to a file. So then you start to think, okay. Maybe, you know, I have my map of airplane seats, you know, and I can also store it to a file. But what's the problem? That you know, if I read a file and you read a file and I write the file and you write it after me, you overwrite what I read. So, I mean, the file system does ensure some level of atomicity. No, I can create a file in the file system, and typical file systems, until I close the file is not visible to. There is a way to create hidden files so that unless I close them and make visible to others, nobody else can access by mistake. Okay. If you go into the gory details of Linux and Unix, there are these tricks to create these kind of objects. But you know, you are getting on yourself the headache that essentially database developers have already had to solve. So rather than using the file system, you might say, well, you know, let's use a database local to my server, because in this way, at least. Concurrent access is handled in a very clean way, and it's very well documented how it works. After all, there is not so much difference between writing a file and writing just the content of a large field in a database. Okay, but then you start to think, the problem is maybe when I get a lot of traffic, I will need a lot of front-end servers, right? So this the way you think of the implementation for the web is that. The front-end servers are the ones that, you know, produce these HTML pages and do work. So here is the user browser. I don't know how to, this is a phone, okay? And once you have a lot of users, you may want to have more than one of these front-ends so that you have enough capacity to support them all. You know, you don't need to be very large, actually, to start needing more than one of these front-end servers for peak load, right? And so, if you have databases or files that are locked into one of these servers, so then clearly, you know, it doesn't work because typically you cannot easily choose where the next request goes. So the idea then is, not only I use a database, but I use a database that sits in some place that is unique. It could be one of the servers, but more typically it's a server specialized for the database. And then you connect to the database, this will have an IP address, okay, I don't know what it will be, but this will connect to the database at that IP address. And so essentially, you don't have global variables, and the information you want to store in some way, one way or another, will be in the database, either associated with the session, which is in the database, or associated with proper database tables, okay? Now, the database, however, is a broad term. So if you don't want to use a MySQL database for everything, nothing prevents you from using other things. For example, if you develop in the Google Cloud, of which I will talk later on in the class, you have a service called Memcache. It's like a key-value storage that is done via memories, very, very fast to read and write. But data gets lost randomly. Usually it lasts, you know, for a few hours, I mean, depending on how busy the site is. But so you can use that as a database that where you have essentially zero cost of reading and writing, which is great. It's incredibly fast, but, you know, things might disappear. For example, for a shopping cart, I mean, if I were designing a mini site like Amazon, you know, maybe I would use Memcache. Maybe that would be a bad idea. I don't know. It would depend on which kind of stuff you're buying, you know. But maybe it's okay that if you put five things in the shopping cart, then you go away for a week, then when you come back, you know, the shopping cart is empty again. You know, why not? Maybe it's a bad idea. But so it's your decision, you know. You can decide how persistent to make the session and this kind of information. So I think this pretty much covers it. Let me think. So essentially in Web2Py, when you run, you have these objects that are available to you always, that are these kind of storage objects. You have more, okay, but these are the main ones. One is a request. Okay, which contains, you know, the variables that are passed to you and all this other information about the request. Another one is response that contains things about your response. This you need much less often because, you know, usually you build the response just via view and so you don't worry so much about it. Another one is a session, okay? And another one is a small thing that is called current, which is essentially just a placeholder for putting code, for putting any value you possibly want that is short-lived. It's there while you process the current request, but it's local to the current request, but it's global to any piece of code you write. So it's the equivalent of a place where to store global variables that have a lifespan that is only the processing of the current request. You may wonder, you know, why you need that. The reason is that it gives you a nice way to access it from all over the place. Let me be a bit more precise. If you want to write additional code, suppose you want to write a big library in Python, okay? Where would you put it? It's not in a controller. If you have a big chunk of code, where do you put it so that it's out of your feet when you write a controller? The place where to put these things that you want out of your feet is modules. Okay, you can create here files that then you can load with the usual Python mechanism of saying import, for example. I can say import blah, okay, and here in a module I can define a module, blah.py, okay? And whatever I write here will be imported, okay? But when you are inside here, you don't have available the variables that are defined in db.py, but you have available the current object, okay? In some way. I will give you an example. But essentially, these are the various objects you have that you can play with. Any questions on how to pass values around? So essentially, writing for the web, yeah, I'll get your question. But is writing code that is, you know, very local to one processing of one request. And if you need persistence, you need to use.
I find something in db.py, can I access it in my HTML file?
Sorry?
I find something in my db.py, I will have access to that file.
Yes, you do. So the Python code that you can put in your views, in your .html files, is very general. It can see exactly all the values that are global variables, as he pointed out, defined in db.py. It can see the request object. It can see the session object. And it can also see any values that you pass to it via dictionary. So let me give you an example. If you want to write a view that behaves in a different way for mobile phones, there is an object. There is something that is called session. I forgot the exact name. Okay, I have to look at the documentation. But I think it's called session dot is underscore mobile. I need to check. Okay, but I believe that one piece that is in the session is this information. And so, in my view, I can very well write if. Session dot is mobile, okay, is mobile, and then I can write what I want to do, and then I can write pass, okay, and this will work to give me an alternate representation in the view when the viewer is on a mobile device. Or for example, another one you can do is request dot auth dot how it is called if auth dot user ID. No, I mean if request dot auth dot user ID or however it is that I forgot the syntax that we access the user ID. So you can you can access that information directly in the view to, for example, give the view a different behavior to logged in users and non logged in users. I think I have an example of this in some code here for CodeGrader that is a similar to the open source one. I don't know if I can show this, but no, this is another thing. Okay, fine. But I have similar code that you that does exactly that. Other questions? Why do I? Yeah? I can also create a class inside Blah, right? I don't know if that's a question. Okay. Okay, thanks.
After I saw